is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unscrupled, covering Buffy the Vampire Slayer, Season 6, Episode 7. What's it called?
Once More with Feeling!
In these episodes, Joss couldn't help himself.
No.
It's just one episode, actually. All right, guys, I don't know how I feel about this. Welcome to Unscrupled.
I touch the fire and it freezes me. I look into it and it's black. Why can't I feel? My skin should crack and peel. I want the fire.
Who the fuck are you?
This is Bitches. Who the fuck are you?
This is Money and I'm not singing it.
Why not?
Because.
But this is Bitches.
Stop it.
What?
I feel violated. I was not warned.
I couldn't warn you. It's unspoiled. You would have yelled at me for warning you.
It was still not consensual.
It was too. You signed on for all that is Buffy, and this is part of it. All
right. Yeah, guys, this was a musical episode. And somewhere in the back of my brain, I knew there was a Buffy episode somewhere that was musical.
They all did it during this time. Xena had one, Xena had two. Buffy had them. Drew Carey was doing it every time you turned around.
I remember the Drew Carey show.
Yeah, wish you didn't, don't you?
No, I actually liked it. I thought it was funny.
Okay.
So.
All right, then.
Yeah.
Well, so that happened to you, and you feel betrayed.
Yep.
But what do you think?
Honestly, it felt padded.
Yeah.
So, like, there's only two real things that happen in this episode.
I disagree, but do tell.
So there's Tara and Willow having a simmering fight.
Okay.
Which is about to bubble over.
Yeah.
And there's Buffy spiraling down and admitting that she's not happy about being alive.
Okay.
And of course, her coping mechanism is to make out with a vampire.
Well, you know, it's the new drug.
Right. I was super excited for Anya and Xander to have some meat to chew on, but, like, it feels kind of, like, I don't know, silly, the things that they're talking about.
Oh, no. Those silly things can absolutely devastate a relationship unless you deal
with them appropriately. I understand that, but I was, like, I thought it was going to be something like Xander wants to... something I haven't seen before, like Xander wants to have sex with more people, or Anya wants to become a vengeance demon again.
Yeah.
You know, like, this is a supernatural show. I don't want your sitcom-y bullshit, you know?
Yeah, you do. You're always wanting more actual, like, things.
It's just, like, this is not, it doesn't feel original to me.
Well, one, it was 20 years ago, and, well, almost, and two,
but even 20 years...
Why do they have to be original?
I just, like, it's every sitcom where someone's about to get married, like, these are the problems they have.
Well, that's, okay, so I know you haven't been married before, but everyone who's about to get married, those are the problems they have. Like, the people who are all blissful and stuff right before their wedding in what has been probably some of the most stressful time in their lives, because let me tell you, people, planning weddings ain't for sissies. It is some fucked up bullshit, and you don't even know till you've been there. But it's kind of like childbirth after you have the big party. Like, people don't talk about that part anymore. Okay, if you talk to the bride, she will get a little drunk and be like, girl, it's been fucked up.
Yeah, weddings are super stressful.
Yeah, they are. So, yeah. So, I feel like I'm burying my point here. My point is going to be that a whole lot more happened during this episode than just those two things. Yes, Buffy absolutely realized that she has some existential issues going on. And yes, Willow and Tara are in a big fight that's going to bubble over any second now. And Willow doesn't realize because she did some shady shit to try and bury that. But we also learned during this that, yeah, Anya and Xander maybe are feeling a little bit of pressure in their relationship, and apparently Dawn has started shoplifting at the magic shop because she's just taking pendants like it's okay.
Is that where that came from?
Yeah, she took. You were looking at your phone, but I saw she stole that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And Giles is realizing that Buffy's not going to blossom into the full flower of adulthood if he sticks around and carries that burden for her. And let's see, what else?
I just, like, why is Giles still here? Like, I
think he's asking himself that very same question. And there's a whole song about it!
I don't... Yeah, but that's the thing about musicals, is that they go on and on and on about the same sentence.
Uh-huh.
And that's kind of why they're hard to review in a show format like this, is because everything is so padded.
Okay. So, a lot... But they talked about a lot of stuff that they hadn't exactly talked about before. And that's kind of the insidiousness of this particular demon, that you say the things in song that normally you keep inside. But I'm getting ahead of myself yet again.
Mm-hmm.
So
which plot threads are we going to dissect first?
I kind of want to talk about your reaction when you realized that it was a musical.
I just, like...
You guys.
I needed some wine.
At first he thought it was going to be a multi-camera sitcom, and he accused me of stuff, and then I'm like, no, no, strap in, it's going to get real. And then once the music started to swell, he made me pause it.
That is not why I made you pause it, because the credits said song and lyrics by Joss Whedon, and I was like, fuck you.
Yep, he made me pause it. He made... my girlfriend go out into the garage to get a bottle of wine, and he asked for a straw.
Mm-hmm. It was...
you guys.
It's... Joss Whedon music feels very, very masturbatory.
And it is. But it's also... It also self-references its masturbatory nature in a lot of fun ways, which I enjoy.
See, whipping out your dick and then saying, haha, look, I'm masturbating, doesn't make me want to see your dick anymore.
Okay, but if you make it fun for everyone, then I don't mind so much. Like, and I find this one delightful.
I'm glad you enjoy it. Like, I want to enjoy it. I want to like Joss Whedon's musical tastes, but I don't.
But I don't, you're know. Not a musical guy.
I'm not. I'm really not.
And that's okay.
Like, yeah, I'm actually sick of The Lion King at this point. So,
wow.
Yeah.
Well, you did see it like 47 times.
I've only seen it 4 times.
Only seen it 4 times.
With 3 exes.
And me.
Yeah.
Okay, so.
Oh, wait, no, only 2, because one was with my family. Okay.
All right, then.
So, anyway, yeah.
You were pretty pissed off at
me. I was. And you
kept telling me about it.
I was, and I don't know. It's more mood whiplash in that now we're supposed to be light and fluffy, whereas like we've been dealing with Buffy's depression for so long.
Yeah, but we've been dealing with light and fluffy things that are happening amidst her depression. I mean. Think about it. Our big bad for the season is 3 dudes in a van.
Yeah.
I mean...
Is that our big bad? I really hope not, because they're just
so
not
far,
that interesting.
So far, that's what we got.
I mean, they're better than Glory.
Yeah.
I mean...
No one's ever going to top the mayor for me.
I mean, that's fair.
Yeah.
I think, on balance, I still like Angelus best as the big bad.
Angelus.
I'm okay. Not going to stop saying it that way.
Angelus.
Stop it.
I'll use your weapons against
it's
you.
It's bad. So, where was I?
So...
All right. So, we open with her... Well, we open with a bunch of people doing shit in the house.
But mostly then, with Buffy singing about how her life is meaningless.
Right. Which is, I feel ya, Buffy, because, you know, she doesn't have a job, and she's been dead, and the world seems to be functioning without her.
Yeah. Why does she have to go back to work?
Right.
Both her jobs. All of her jobs. So many jobs!
And she's killing vampires.
And demons.
And a demon.
Yeah. And a hunky guy steps out from behind the tree all ready to, for her to swoon at. And she's just like, nope, got no time for you, hunkster.
You know who he reminds me of?
Who?
That person who's in our house quite a bit.
Oh, that one?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, he's got that kind of an air.
He's got that smile.
Yeah.
So, let's see, where was, yeah, so she's bored and feels like everything is routine and nothing is interesting.
Yeah.
And then Tara and Willow are having a, oh my God, we're so in love.
Yeah, they've been having a lot of that ever since Willow mind raped her.
Yeah, I wouldn't, is that the right word?
She took away the memory of a fight so that she could have control over their relationship.
It still doesn't feel like rape is the right word to put on that. Mm. It's definitely a violation, but do you know what it feels like? It feels like in high school when people would say, like, I did really well on a test, so they would say, I raped that test. And I'm like, one, no. Two, you did something to the test, but that was not it.
Yeah, I would never do. Okay, so
it was clearly a violation.
So with Tara as the survivor of an apocalyptic mind screw up thing that was done to her like that, I think it's not on the same level as Glory, but it was definitely a non-consensual violation of her innermost self. And I have trouble finding a different word for that.
I mean, sure. So, all right. Yeah, fine, whatever.
Okay. You don't have to be completely.
And this is actually this plot development in Willow's taking Tara's memory of their fights is, I think, really good as far as Willow biting off more than she can chew. Getting lectured at by Giles just makes me want her to fuck up shit even more.
Well, yes. But fuck the patriarchy.
Yeah, but it's, I can, this is really cool in that, like, Willow is starting to lose perspective on when you step over that line. And we all kind of do it.
Yeah. So do you think this is the beginning of a small spiral or a grand spiral?
This is definitely a grand spiral because this is not a, like, there are no small spirals in
in TV.
In Buffy. Like, okay. Things go off into the stratosphere a lot.
That's fair.
Yeah.
Okay.
There's no, like, I mean, Xander feels bored and unloved.
Yeah.
And he, there's never, hey guys, I feel like I'm not included. No, he has to go save the entire city while being not included.
This is true.
Yeah.
Okay, so, all right, you feel like this is going to lead to more badness.
Yeah.
How did you feel about their whole kind of like walking around being blithely in love while this thing had happened? Did you think about that and how it wasn't going to, how maybe it would last, maybe it wouldn't? Did you just kind of let it wash over you? And then
I was a little too lost in the, oh my God, here is a same-sex couple doing the musical thing.
Yeah,
even for its time, like,
that their music together, their whole like musical interlude was so incredibly sexual. Holy crap.
Yeah.
Like, at the time, I didn't quite pick it. Like, I picked up that it was sexy and stuff, but, like, listening to the lyrics again now, when I'm, like, super paying attention so that I can podcast about it.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my God. There's, like, it's not even a double entendre. It's just they're having sex right there.
I know. She's literally eating her pussy and making her float above the bed.
Yeah, and saying, you make me come, pleat.
Yep.
You make me come. Yeah, she does. She is spread beneath her willow tree, and she's complete.
Yeah.
Yep.
So, I guess Tara has been training her?
Well, you know, some things you just figure out, and some people are naturals.
Okay.
I found this out.
I feel like Willow wouldn't be, just because of having seen her grow up. I don't feel like physically she's very adventurous.
I find that sometimes people are Vulcans in the streets and Klingons in the sheets.
Okay.
And once they have that inner sexy beast unleashed, it kind of rampages around in the best way.
At the age of 21?
Sure.
Okay.
Remember all those girls I fucked in college?
Yes.
Yes. I have a lot of experience with 21-year-old girls.
Okay.
Yeah.
I assumed you were leading mostly, because I've never actually seen you fuck.
No. If I have to teach them
except for that one.
Well, yeah, that one. But yeah, if I have to teach them a whole lot, I kind of lose interest. Right. I want them to want to try stuff.
Okay.
Yeah. So, but anyway. So, yeah, that was sexy and awesome. And then they, and then, and for Tara finds that flower and figures out what it means.
Right. So her memory has been wiped. And yeah. So she and Giles get a lot of spotlight time in this.
They get a duet. And it's kind of an interesting duet because they're not like actually together or singing about the same thing at all, but they are singing the same words, which I thought was pretty decent.
Yeah.
It's one of my favorite songs in the show.
Okay.
Yeah. But yeah, they're both singing about how they really got a bail on this toxic relationship they're in.
Mm-hmm.
And they wish they didn't have to because they love the person so much. But shit's fucked up, gotta go.
Right.
Yeah.
So Willow, like, Tara is
too good for Willow.
Well, it's I'm trying to get on, like, is this a extinction level event for the relationship?
That's fair.
And honestly, I think it should be.
Well, yeah.
But in the real world, but it's also, I'm also thinking the logistics of making a television show. But I'd also like a soft exit for Tara, because, like, Tara is, Amber Benson is not in the main cast, and we all know what happens to love interests who are not in the main cast.
Yeah, they get iced,
especially with the gays thing. So, yeah.
It could, yeah, it's a scary time for the secondary characters.
Right.
Yeah.
How many secondary characters are alive? I think there's Jonathan.
I'm really bad at counting those.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know who counts as secondary and who counts as primary.
I generally use, like, if your name's in the opening credits, you're primary. If you appear after the opening credits on the bottom of the screen, you're secondary. And anything beyond that, you're tertiary. So.
Okay. What about very special guest stars?
Those would probably be secondary.
Fair. Okay. So.
I mean, they're short-lived, but they're clearly very important.
Okay. So, let's see. I think that's, is there anything else more to say about Willow and Tara and their drama?
Yeah, I don't know. I want Tara to leave her.
Okay. Well, it looks like Tara's kind of gearing up for that, so we'll see how it goes.
Because I did not get that feeling from her. I got her articulating that. I did not see the resolve to actually do it, though.
Mm. Well, you have to gear up emotionally before you can gear up physically.
Right, but it's...
Having walked away from a number of relationships, they're all like 90% of the work happens before you make the decision.
It makes me question whether Tara can.
Okay.
Because she clearly loves Willow, and is she going to be like, okay, we're going to have this fight, and then...
But there's something she can say that will make it all better?
No, when it's not so heated, Willow will finally understand how terrible this was.
Huh.
Like, I've been in the situation where someone will realize the gravity of what they've done later.
Yeah.
Right, and you sort of kind of bank on that.
Ah,
you know what I'm talking about, don't you?
I abso-fucking-lutely do.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, when she's less of an asshole, she'll realize and be sorry, and then it'll be okay. And
right.
She'll never do it again.
Right.
Yeah.
And sometimes that happens, and sometimes it doesn't. Because, you know, in the middle of a fight, you get defensive. And, like, trying to keep your ground. So sometimes that works. And then later, when they cool down, they're like, yeah, I shouldn't do that. But sometimes they don't, because...
Sometimes that's the hill they're going to die on.
Right.
And your relationship dies with them.
Right.
Yeah, that's fair. Okay. So...
But I do see, like, Willow, is this new power is important to Willow.
Oh, yeah.
And this
thing
is...
where she's kind of a minor demigod.
Right.
Yeah.
And I, from her perspective, I can kind of see, like, someone's got to be. Because there is no magic for good on this Hellmouth.
Hmm. Yeah. But she's gotten so blasé about it. She's casual about magic in a way that is, you're right, scary.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But some, like, we need something scary on the good side.
Uh-huh. We absolutely do.
And I firmly believe that's how you get the mayor. Like, yeah. I think back when he was a young non-immortal, he was probably dabbling to do things that he thought were good.
Well, yeah.
And it kind of snowballed. So
I mean, you can just fix society if you change it a little bit here and there, right?
Right.
Remove a little free will, put a couple safeguards in place, and everyone's happy and mm-hmm. identical. Yeah.
I don't feel that's what the mayor was up to, but...
Well, it may not be what the mayor was up to, but that's what you get to eventually.
Mm-hmm. So.
So, anyway, next couple. I think this is... Well, we talked a little bit about Xander and Anya. Is there anything else we need to say about
I just, them? Like... I really want Anya's past to play a much bigger role than it does.
Okay.
Because, like, I was super excited about Anya being torn from the world of being a vengeance demon and thrown into one of being a late teens, early 20s.
Yeah.
But she seems like a Cordy Light, and it her past doesn't really seem to come up very often. Her struggles with her relationship with Xander are things any other woman would have, and not like, I've spent 1,000 years by myself. Why do I feel something for this? Like, it doesn't seem to factor into it. It's regular
I disagree.
On TV relationship stuff.
I disagree. She's having all those normal relationship issues, but she's dealing with them as someone who has a very strange point of reference for that.
How?
Well, most of the time she's kind of flummoxed, and honestly, I expected her to try to turn him into frogs at some point.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, she's just kind of like frustrated a lot. And that seems to be who she is. She deals with things by trying to logic them out and confront them directly. It's like, Xander, we're going to talk about this thing that's bothering me. And sometimes that turns out okay for her, and sometimes she just gets a little bit patted on the head. And that part's frustrating for me. But, okay. So do you
think... She's, her directness doesn't draw from being a vengeance demon. I feel like she's granted a lot of passive-aggressive wishes in her time.
Right.
Towards lovers who are also passive-aggressive. I feel like she would have a much better grasp of the subtle relationship dance.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, speaking of subtle relationship dances, they did some. How did you feel about the problems that they addressed during their musical interlude? Yeah.
Like, I have cold feet and this is forever. Like, I firmly believe they're too young to get married.
Well, yeah, but everyone is.
That's fair.
Yeah.
But they're in their early 20s. Like, this is... They're not done evolving as adults.
Okay.
So, tell you something?
Always.
You know how our awesome listeners send us all kinds of cool Harry Potter-themed stuff? Mm-hmm. Pop dolls, books, journals, candy. I mean, they send us so much stuff.
Yeah.
I kind of still want more stuff.
You greedy bitch.
I know. Don't tell anybody.
Remember when you used to make fun of people who had Harry Potter stuff?
I know. What happened to me? You happened to me. And now every time I see Harry Potter anything, I want it. But I see a lot of the same stuff over and over again. Sometimes they'll have Ravenclaw stuff with fucking ravens on it.
Well, now that you mention it, I do know somewhere that you can get really unusual, handmade Harry Potter items shipped to you every month. And they know that Ravenclaw's animal is an eagle because they're not a bunch of goddamn posers.
Ooh, tell me.
It's our new sponsor, AccioBox. They're giving everyone who subscribes with the code UNSPOILED 10% off their first three boxes. And every month, you get 3 to 5 specially curated items, including at least one that is specific to your house, all delivered right to your door.
This sounds amazing.
I know, right? And because AccioBox focuses on unique handcrafted items, you're also supporting a series of other small businesses. Plus, you're guaranteed to not have the same gear as some filthy casual who picked up a Raven keychain at Walmart.
Well, I'm a lot of things, but you know I'm not casual.
Not a casual bone in your body. That's why AccioBox is for you.
Well, shit, girl, where do I sign up?
AccioBox.com. And don't forget to look for them on Facebook and Instagram, too. Facebook.com/TheAccioBox and Instagram.com/TheAccioBox.
What's the code again?
Really?
I'm sorry, I forgot.
The code is UNSPOILED.
That makes total sense.
AccioBox. Magic delivered.
So, with that in mind,
And
with them actually starting to address some of the very basic relationship problems that everyone has, but they don't know how to because they've never been in a serious relationship before, do you think that they're going to make it?
No.
Okay.
I don't feel like Xander really trusts Anya.
Okay.
Like, he wants her to keep quiet about a lot of things.
Mm-hmm.
We don't know much about how Xander is an adult, is because he's been off to the side for most of the adult seasons, but I feel like he doesn't have a good grasp on what it means to be a partner.
Okay.
He only has a grasp on performed masculinity.
Mm-hmm.
And Anya is, I don't even know how to feel about Anya's place in this. So Anya, I just feel like her past doesn't seem to play out into her personality very well.
I
like her personality, but I don't think this is what someone who spent 1,000 years punishing men would be like.
That's fair. I don't think she's a good representation of what I think a vengeance demon should be like.
Mm-hmm.
But she does, in her human form and in this relationship, she's having all this anxiety about growing old and having to perform humanity.
Right.
As in the way that people perform gender. And that's so fascinating. Like, she's always trying to figure out, it's like, what should I be doing right now? What should I be feeling right now?
Mm-hmm.
I know the things that I like, and I'll express them with enthusiasm, but people keep looking at me funny, and I hate that shit.
Yeah, that's right. Where we differ is that I think being 1,000 years of a demon who spends a lot of time pretending to be human would make her better at that, not worse.
Well, the thing is, she didn't really have to pretend to be human very much. She, like, went to Sunnydale High for, like, a day and a half, and then created a whole wish verse.
Well, yeah, but that's for one wish. And also, like, I feel like she takes more wish requests from women than men.
Well, yeah.
Especially considering her history of how she became a vengeance demon.
Well, yeah.
And I don't know. It's like, given she's going to be doing a lot of very ironic, evil, cackling things that have to do with relationship wrongs. And yeah, I feel like someone with that much data would have a really good grasp on how relationships work.
I think they'd have a really good grasp of how relationships go wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And would lead to, I don't know, massive anxiety about your relationship.
Okay. Sure. Okay.
So, should we go on to the next couple?
The next couple is Giles and Buffy?
Nah, the next couple is Buffy and Spike.
I'm still processing this.
Okay, so before we get to the thing where Buffy kissed Spike at the end,
mm-hmm.
I think we need to talk about Buffy going to see Spike at his in his crypt and him trying to usher her out before he accidentally broke into song.
Right.
And then his, you know, breakaway pop hit.
Which one was that?
Oh, he sings about how he really wishes she would just leave him the fuck alone, but he also acknowledges that he's following her around because he's in love with him and he's doing the creepy dude thing.
Mm-hmm.
And he doesn't say he hates himself for it, but he does say that, like, I can't stop feeling this thing and it's awful. And would you please just bugger the fuck off?
Right.
But don't go.
Yeah, I mean, that is very true of Spike and Buffy. Like, it is kind of cruel for Buffy to keep coming around when she knows Spike feels this way. Because you can't scab over if you keep picking at it.
It's true. And I've had crushes before, and they do kind of feel like that. Like, once you realize that your crush is never going to love you,
mm-hmm.
having them just, like, being in your face and being kind of, like, deliberately alluring is torture.
Right.
So, ladies and gentlemen, if you know someone has a crush on you, don't take advantage of them. It's mean.
Right.
But also, if you have a crush on someone and you know they're not down, don't hang out with them.
Yeah.
Don't like hang around waiting for them to like someday love you, because they're not gonna. You got to get some distance so that you can love someone who can love you back.
Right.
That's all. That's my advice from me to you today.
Yeah, and I'm also still like, Buffy, why is, like, why have you not staked him at this point?
Because he's useful.
Sure.
He looked after her kid sister while she was dead.
Yeah. I just, like, how did they ever get to this point?
Well, we watched it happen, dude.
I know, but, like, I had problems with it here, too. Like, how did we get into a situation where Buffy would be kissing Spike? It's like,
a lot of manipulation.
Right. A lot
like,
of
seriously, it
TV
took,
writer magic.
It took 3 seasons of them fucking with this character to put them in a place where this could happen.
Right. So, yeah, like, Buffy's being cruel, like, and I'm not 100% sold on why she keeps going to Spike to talk about her feelings.
Oh, because he's the only one she can trust with her sadness.
Okay.
Like, he's the only one who's not going to be super hurt emotionally finding out that she was in heaven, because he didn't bring her back. I mean, he would have been down.
Right.
But, like he hasn't got any guilt tied up in that. And even if he had been put in on the plan to bring her back, he's evil. He doesn't experience guilt.
Right.
So she knows that she's not burdening him in any way that she's responsible for. By, you know, telling him about her experience, he's the one person in the world who kind of understands what it is to have too much life.
Okay.
And have it not be good anymore.
All right.
Because, I mean, really, has anyone else on the show been this depressed?
Angel?
Yeah, but she can't have him. He would absolutely understand, and she can't have him.
So, yeah. I don't know. Like,
okay.
It makes sense as a coping mechanism to want to make out with Spike.
Oh, yeah. It's like, Like when you have a family member die that you're really close to and you go on a 3-day bender. That's what Spike is. He's a big bottle of cheap hooch.
I've never had an actual hooch.
I think hooch is what you make of it. Like you can have a wine cooler and call it hooch.
I want in some point in my life to actually try like jailhouse hooch.
Oh, we could just make some. I mean,
wanna try that?
We've got all the stuff.
Yeah. We even got a toilet tank.
We're not doing it in the toilet. I draw the line. We have proper brewing equipment. We cannot get like scabies or whatever from our hooch.
You have a curious understanding of infectious disease vectors.
Hey, whatever we would get from our prison hooch would be as bad or worse than scabies. Yeah, I feel it like it's dead.
Because that's where no one looks.
You know what? We'll talk about this later in the house meeting.
Okay.
So, moving right along, I guess the next pair off would be Buffy and Giles.
Yeah, it's a lot of Giles articulating things that I've been thinking for a couple seasons now, except he's not being hard enough on himself.
Well, he does say that he needs to bail and he wishes he could stay and it's tearing him up inside. What more do you want?
I want him to acknowledge that he's a vestige of a oppressive institution that makes its money off the back of young women and sort of, I don't know. This is like, we've seen Buffy kind of grab power by the horns.
Mm-hmm.
And we're watching Willow do the same.
Yes.
Part of that means, like, at some point, confrontation with Giles.
And Willow had hers.
No, they had an argument.
Okay.
They did not, like...
Confront.
I feel like the confrontation is going to be a lot bigger.
Okay.
And a lot more dangerous. And, like, maybe factions will have to form or someone will get betrayed somehow. This is not just an argument. This is...
Okay.
So...
All right.
Yeah. I think Giles needs to be off this show in that the show has moved beyond him.
Okay.
And the only reason he's still around is, like, I don't get it. I'm not seeing what the point is.
He's the last adult.
Right.
So, okay, let's...
But they're all adults now. That's something that's crucially important to how the show works, is that everyone there, except for Dawn, is an adult.
Well, see, that's the thing, though. It's kind of hard to figure out where that line is. I mean, sure, legally, you turn 18, you're an adult, and suddenly you're expected to do some adulty things. But in reality, it's a way more gradual process.
Yes, but part of being an adult also is adulting when you're not ready.
Yeah, because you're never ready.
Giles is kind of the show's safety net. And he keeps doing things like being the one to kill Ben when that would be an important character growth moment for anyone else on the show. But no, they're stuck on this, like, you know, killing someone is...
It's wrong.
Yeah. And like, yeah, they did it with Cordelia. And it's like, no, like sometimes these people have a lot of responsibility and have all the skin in the game. This is something they should be doing and not giving to someone who...
has already learned that
lesson. Exactly.
Yeah. Okay, so let's play this out. Let's say Giles bails and he's just gone. What happens then?
I feel like what we're going to have is a confrontation between Willow and Buffy. I feel like Willow is going to... Because, like, it can't... Willow's going to do something fucked up. And Buffy's going to confront her on it, and I don't think Willow's going to back down. And I think that's where Willow's arc is going, is that she's not going to listen to reason.
If they did have a throwdown, do you think Buffy could take her?
Well, obviously, because the show is Buffy, not Willow.
Okay.
Unless they're going to kill her again.
How'd you like the throwaway line? Hey, I've died twice.
The throwaway line I liked most was, I think this line is mostly filler.
Everyone loves that. Yeah. Like, seriously, it's quite possibly the best part of the show.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean the whole show, not just this episode.
Right.
But okay.
I feel like that's the challenge that I think is facing Buffy this year. Mm-hmm. Is we don't really have a big bad, and you try to point to these three assholes, but I'm like, I don't see it. They're slapstick. They're not
mm-hmm.
scary.
Is it possible that they realized that they were dealing with such heavy shit in the personal lives of the characters that maybe they didn't need an apocalypse level monster for the season?
I hope so.
Because, I mean, this what's happening is kind of what you've been asking for.
Yeah.
A little bit.
Yeah.
So, anyway. So, what else is there? There's Dawn. There's...
Do we care?
We don't care about Dawn. She's been shoplifting. She gets kidnapped by a demon to become his demon.
Why couldn't his suit fit?
It's a zoot suit, darling. It's meant to be like that.
I want to set it on fire.
Okay. He did not wear a zoot suit well. It's like he didn't know how.
He was like, it wasn't just like baggy on him. It was also too long.
Yeah, that's the style. It's, you know, a style from the 40s. So yeah, it's its own thing. Anyway, so should we talk about our monster of the week?
So he's here because someone summoned him, and that was Xander.
Yeah.
And Xander was bored.
Xander was bored. He played with a spell. Naughty Xander.
Uh-huh.
He thought it would be fun. And he killed, like, probably half a dozen people.
Yeah, they totally didn't need that at all.
Yeah, the thing where, like, people died and everyone's just fine with Xander fucking around with rando magic, even though it's killing people, mm-hmm. really bothers me. And I really want them to, like, kick the crap out of Xander.
Yeah, but it's also... it's trying to artificially raise the stakes, and... it could also be like, guys, I'm tired from singing all the time and dancing.
Wait, what do you mean?
What is their impetus to stopping the musical curse? It doesn't have to be that people are dying. It can be that people are tired.
Or that it's interrupting them from doing important things. Like,
right, or it's revealing secrets.
Yeah. Or that it's revealing secrets. Like, yeah, people didn't have to die for this to be something they wanted to stop.
Right.
Yeah, it's causing strife.
And then there's this whole Persephone angle where he wants to take Dawn as his queen.
Yeah, that was a little weird. But, you know, I guess demons only have one thing on their mind, and it's child brides.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So. yeah. Buffy reveals that she went to heaven.
Yeah.
Not some interdimensional hell. And that shocks the fuck out of Willow.
Yeah, Willow's face in that moment,
mm-hmm.
like, kind of haunts me.
Yeah.
Because it's like, aw, shit. No, it's not like, aw, shit at all. It's like, oh, fuck, what did I do? And yeah, leave well enough alone, Willow. Sometimes people are meant to be dead.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Stop fucking with nature.
Mm-hmm. Spring Faith from jail already.
Yeah, really? I mean, they could have had a Slayer, but it's not Buffy. And honestly, she wanted her friend back.
Yeah, I get that.
Yeah.
But, like, I don't know. There's been several times when Willow has wanted her friend back.
Yeah.
And I feel like Joyce and Miss Carpenter and Kendra should be on that list somewhere. Maybe not at the top, but...
Okay, to be fair, Willow wasn't strong enough then.
That was then. She is now.
Yeah. They've been dead and gooey for a while.
So what?
Like, where even is Kendra's corpse?
It's probably back in the Caribbean, but yeah, Buffy's corpse was looking pretty gross too. I don't think they embalmed her.
No, they didn't. She had rotted real good.
Yeah.
But they did say that, you know, those urns of Osiris are hard to come by, and there was only that one left, and they got it on eBay, but still, it's not like she's got half a dozen of them and can just bring back the Alterno Scooby game at ease. She had to pick
like,
one. She picked her best friend.
Okay. I feel like if she could... It feels like a logical step for Willow to try and figure out how to manufacture these things.
Well, yeah, but that's like us. But I want us to, like, promise something right now. I want you to promise me, if I die tragically, don't bring me back from the dead. Just let me be dead. Even if it's a hell dimension.
No. We're totally doing Weekend at Bernie's with your boss.
Oh, God. No, you can take my corpse around. Just leave it a corpse.
Okay.
Okay? Like, yeah, do whatever you want to my body. Just leave it dead.
All right.
Okay. That's all I'm asking, man. Because I might be in heaven.
I'm going to have you stuffed like that episode of Scrubs with the stuffed dog.
I haven't seen Scrubs.
Yes, we watched this together. Okay. Where like, they would move the dog and she would turn. And they'd be like, Rowdy, no.
Okay, yeah. I did see that. That was pretty fun. Yes.
I just put you outside the shower when Gwen's getting out.
She's like, baby, what?
No, just you're standing there. She doesn't explain. Ah!
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, like, this is kind of on topic with what they're discussing in Dresden Files, too, because they're at the Necromancer book, where...
I only got 3 books in.
Okay.
Yeah, so... Don't spoil me. I might go back to it, except I probably won't because his writing style makes me nuts.
Well, you know James Marsters reads the audiobooks, right?
Well, that could be fun. Maybe
I'll give it a try. He's pretty good at it, too.
Okay. Well, I do like his voice. It's, I mean, as fucked up as Spike gets at points, like, I really like James Marsters.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's fun.
So now everyone has a bunch of emotional baggage they need to start carrying.
I think this represents the emotional baggage they were carrying already, but now everybody else knows about it.
Right. Now they have to actually deal with it.
Which,
and unpack it.
Which is the best part of a musical episode.
Sure.
I think it's fun.
Okay.
Let's see. I think we covered all the major salient points.
I'm sorry I didn't enjoy this as much as you wanted me to. But...
I knew you weren't going to like it. But I love
it. I didn't not like it, but...
Well, yeah, you didn't hate it with the fiery passion of 1,000 suns the way I suspected you might. So that's cool. But you're never going to love it the way I love it because, mm-hmm. one, you're not a musical guy. And two, you're not really a Buffy guy. You're tolerating it because I want it and because it's very popular and because, yeah. like, this is a portion of pop culture that you actually really need to know about.
Yeah, I'm getting a lot more references now.
Yeah.
So, there are some musicals that I like. I like Chicago.
Everyone likes Chicago.
So.
You're not human if you don't like Chicago. I'm just going to put it out there.
I like Avenue Q.
Yeah, that's also super fun.
Mama Mia can fuck right off.
Haven't seen it. Don't know.
Don't care.
Hamilton's amazing. You don't know yet.
All right. It's only been 2 days, so we only have 3 new patrons. Gary French, Simone Frigerio, and Alexandra Keller. So, welcome, guys. I'm really hoping you have an answer to this, bitches.
Yeah.
What are we watching next week?
Oh, we're watching... We're going to do 2 Angels, and...
So we're going to be ahead of an Angel.
We're going to be ahead in Angel, but not for very long.
Okay.
Because after that, we're going to do 3 Buffys.
Really?
Yeah. We will catch up in this way. It was important to do this episode by itself, and now you know why.
Yeah.
And I think you agree. But we're either going to do 3 Buffys after the next 2 Angels or 3 Buffys after the next 2 Buffys. But 3 Buffys are going to happen in order to get us back on track.
Okay.
I don't want us to be off track for more than a week. And there's the next several Angel episodes I don't think are strong enough to carry their own show.
Okay.
In my opinion.
All right. So apparently we're going to be doing a threefer at some point. That's going to be a really long episode.
Maybe.
Okay.
Maybe. We'll see.
All right, guys. We love you all. Thank you. Sing your problems away.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
Bye.
The flame to save the day or maybe melt away. I guess it's all the same. So I will walk through.
childbearer is scorching me. Buffy's laughing, I know the doubt. I hope she fries, I'm free if that bitch dies. I better help her out, cause she is drawn to the fire. Some people she will never learn, and she will walk through the fire and let it. Will this do a thing to change her? Am I leaving Dawn in danger? Is my slayer too far gone to care? What if Buffy can't defeat it?
Beady eyes is right where needed. Or we could just sit around and glare.
We'll see it through, it's what we're always here to do. So we will walk through the fire.
So one by one they turn from me. I guess my friends can't face the cold.
What can't we do?
But why I froze, not one among them knows. And never can be told.
She came from the grave, much graver.
Still kill her, then I'll save her.
Everything is turning out so dark.
No one save her, then I'll kill her.
In what they had, mostly killer.
It's what they had to strike a spark.
These endless days are finally ending in a place.
And we are caught in the fire. The point of no return.
Spoiled Network Podcast.